So I want to start by reminding all of us that bilingual education has always been constructed and negotiated between two positions. One is, of course, the position of the nation state, in our case, of course, English, that of being monolingual and English only. And then this bilingual angle of the children in the communities that we work with. And it has always been a negotiation of how we do it. And I think the tensions that we experience today are a result precisely of these two positions that sometimes do not reconcile with each other. I want to remind you, because I'm a lot older than you are, I'm glad that Luis Reyes is in the audience, who has been part of the struggle for many years. I want to remind you that this did not start just because some people wanted it. It started because there was an era of civil rights, because communities took it upon themselves to demand that their children be educated in a language that they understood. And that's something that sometimes we lose track of. And I want to remind you that during that time, of course, there were bilingual education programs that were started for language minoritized communities in the US, namely transitional bilingual education programs that we're all very aware of, and what are one-way developmental maintenance bilingual education programs. They are often just at the elementary level, and there are fewer and fewer of those. But these were the efforts of a community struggle that we cannot just forget about. So it's good to be reminded. But I also want to remind you that since that time, there have been a lot of erasures here in California, of course, with Proposition 227, and elsewhere the same thing. We have experienced it in New York also. The silencing of the word bilingual, the silencing of bilingual programs, and we have really stepped back from some commitments that were then forged during that time. There have and continue to be development of bilingual education programs in the US. The transitional programs continue, even though sometimes less than we would like. The one-way developmental bilingual education programs, often known as dual language bilingual education, continue sometimes under the guise that they're two-way, but they continue. I think the big change that we've had in the last 20 years, 15 years, is of course that we have developed a model that is more heteroglossic, that includes children that are both minority students and majority students, the two-way immersion bilingual education programs that continue to be very few and that continue to be mostly at the elementary level. And of course, there is also a trend now to start immersion bilingual education for majority students. So this is new. This is what has been added in the last 15 years or so, and that is growing. But we have to remember what it is that we have lost. Regardless, I think what we need to remember is whether the programs are transitional in nature, or what I call DLB, because I think we want to, everybody has to be reminded that dual language programs are bilingual programs. If we don't name our bilingualism, who will? So these DLB programs, or even the immersion bilingual education programs, what we have to remember is that they operate, whether they're transitional or dual or immersion, they operate with a mentality that a language is an autonomous system that is static, right? So with transitional programs, we are thinking of subtractive bilingualism, taking away the child's home language and adding a second one. With additive bilingualism, we're also thinking of just adding another wheel. But the idea and the way in which we look at these programs is still that these are separate wheels that need to be kept separate. So we do all this because we continue to believe in two separate, that our children should be two separate monolinguals, able to, of course, meet state standards both in English and in the LOAT, in the language other than English, and that the performances of these children need to be monolingual balanced performances. Of course, this has to do with our ideology that languages are simply structures, right? Structures that are acquired linearly. And again, this is denying or not recognizing a whole body of work stemming from the Bakhtin circle that sees language not as structures, as given to us by the Swiss sociolinguist Saussure or even by Noam Chomsky, but that languages are really action, cognitive and social actions that really take place in interaction with each other. So, but we continue to think of this, of language as structures that could be taught and that can be acquired linearly. And that is again because we continue to believe that the first language, and I'm talking here about a first language, an L1, is in a diglossic relationship with the second language, with the L2. That, of course, means that there has to be a functional separation between the two languages, that one language is spoken in some domains and the other language is spoken in the other domain. That Spanish, for example, is spoken at the home and that English is spoken in the English and that they never touch. We also believe and continue to believe that English is the target language, is what we really care about, whereas the other language is really just about looking backwards, it's really just our heritage. And we see children as categories, we see children as being either English speakers or being English language learners, and never recognizing the fact that there's a whole continuum of bilingualism that is ignored when we make these categories. Because of these ideologies, we have set up programs, structures, educational program structures of language separation, whether they're monolingual programs in which the child's home language is excluded, ESL programs sometimes included, or bilingual programs where the languages are strictly separated. This is all part of this ideology that languages, again, are autonomous structures that need to be kept separate. As a result, we have paid a lot of attention to language allocation policy, which of course what they do is they build these structures of separation. We have paid a lot of attention to the macro alternation of languages, and we fight whether the best approach is to have it 100% or to have 90%, which then slides to 50%, or 50%, 50% from the beginning. So we have conceptualized all these programs in terms of percentages because, again, we believe and we continue to believe that languages are autonomous structures that could be acquired linearly. And these language allocation policies tend to be quite rigid. The same happens when we talk about pedagogies. We have developed only pedagogies of separation, where the first language is separate from the second language, and the micro-alternation of languages is considered illegal. So what I'm saying is that we have paid a lot of attention to the macro alternation, and we have decided that any micro alternation of languages within our bilingual programs is illegal. So again, the macro, rigid, the micro, illegal. And what I want to do today is present you with an alternative view. It's an alternative view, of course, that comes from the changes that have taken place in society, of our changes in our conceptualization of language, of bilingualism, because it's a result of a lot more movement of people, of products, of information, and technology that allows the simultaneity of language practices at the same time. So, our conception of language has shifted from seeing language, again, as a system of structures that can be acquired linearly, to seeing language more as action, what is then post as languaging. It's an action. That's what we have to get the kids to do. Even the standards, I think, emphasize languaging and not just language. And so the question I think that we have to pose at this time in 2014, especially in a NABE conference, is how do we reconstruct bilingual education in the United States for our, on the one hand, our globalized world of plurilingual resources, and on the other hand, for social justice of minoritized people and the immigrants that continue to come. So how do we reconstruct it? How do we build then on the languages and cultural practices of bilingual communities and their children? Something that bilingual education programs often ignore, right? They often ignore the fact that within the Spanish speakers, there may be kids who speak Mixteco, Quechua, whatever. And that the bilingualism of these children, that is not just strictly a standardized academic language, is always ignored. So how do we build on these practices? I want to remind you that all our language practices are as bilinguals are fluid. It is what we do in the family, that's my family, when we talk to each other. It is what we do in our context, right? These practices are a lot more fluid, especially when they want to sell us something. And I want to quote a child who really gave me the whole idea to sort of move from bilingualism as an additive construct to thinking about bilingualism as a dynamic construct. Because when I sat next to him, it was a sixth grade class, dual language, bilingual class, and when I asked him about his languaging, he said to me, even though Spanish runs through my heart, English rules my veins. So I started thinking of how it is that we can then teach to make sure that this child's language system, which is one system, is not separated. How do we then continue to develop the blood that flows through his heart at the same time that the blood that flows through his veins, because otherwise what we have is, of course, death. So this led me, of course, to this idea of dynamic bilingualism, the idea that, of course, bilingualism is just not additive, that our two wheels are not always the same, they're not always inflated in the same way, they're not always going in the same direction, but that bilingualism is adaptive. It adapts to the terrain, to the craters and the ridges of communication as we interact with others. It's a much more active concept of bilingualism than what additive bilingualism gives us. And of course, the idea that what we have to do with bilingual children is not to teach them two separate texts, because after all, they are not two separate monolinguals in one. What we have to do is make sure that as one, they actually read an integrated text. So this is what led many of us to think of translanguaging as an alternative. Let me just then make sure that we understand what it is. Translanguaging was a term coined by Welsh scholars. It was actually a Welsh teacher, Ken Williams, who defined it as a pedagogy to make sure that the Welsh children develop the Welsh as well as English. And what he did was he designed a pedagogy in which the input was in one language and the output was in the other language. So the children would read in one language and write in another, or speak in one language and read in the other. So there was an alternation of the languages. And since Ken Williams introduced it very early, many of us have extended this use to acknowledge a flexible use of the full bilingual repertoire of children, especially in teaching and learning. And there are many of us who have worked with this concept. Translanguaging then is not about having a separate L1 and an L2. As a matter of fact, in this epistemological consideration, we do away with the concept of first and second language. What we have then is a full linguistic repertoire, a linguistic repertoire that is, I'm not going to say hybrid, I'm going to say fluid, and I'm not going to say hybrid because I don't believe that it's mixed. What I do believe is that what we're talking about is one language repertoire with features that are then societally assigned to one language or the other. And of course, to recognize the fact that this is the discursive norm of bilinguals, and they're not simply, we're not simply talking about separate structures, a first language and a second language. If I can take you through this diagram for a second, I think it will explain the difference as we have developed this concept. In traditional bilingualism, you have two separate languages with features that belong to each of the systems. Jim Cummins, very, very long ago, real pioneer, introduced us to his idea of linguistic interdependence. The idea of linguistic interdependence is that there is a transfer between the first and second language because there is a common underlying proficiency. Those of us working on translanguaging go a step beyond the interdependence. The idea, of course, is that we're talking about one language system with features that are continuous, and features, of course, that are then socially constructed as English or and then the Spanish or the Lote, but with bilinguals usually functioning in this translanguaging space that slides into English or Spanish or a Lote, depending on the societal circumstances. So the question for all of us then is how do we reconstruct bilingual education and how do we move forward with translanguaging? Notice that this is an oar, one oar, a single oar, with two paddles, I guess. I don't know, but the idea, of course, is that if you only go in one direction, you're going around in circles, right? So you need to be able to move both in order to move forward, and that is what we're talking about here. So reconstructing bilingual education with translanguaging means using some translanguaging strategies, that is paying attention to the micro-alternation of languages that has been rendered illegal in most bilingual classes. And I am not saying do it randomly, I'm saying do it strategically. Think of how to do this, developing a pedagogy of translanguaging. And then within bilingual programs, how do you build, how can you build a translanguaging space? So paying attention both to the strategies, which have to do with the micro-alternation, and then to the space, which has to do with our language allocation policies. A lot of this, the work that we're doing in New York City is related to a project in which I'm involved, CUNY NYSIB. You can look up all our work in on the website. It's the New York State Initiative on Emergent Bilinguals, and it's a project that involves many of us, the principal investigators being Ricardo Tegui, myself, and Kate Mencken, and a very, very big team of CUNY faculty and teacher education alongside doctoral students, and we have felt that this is the best way of doing it. We have developed a lot of material, including a translanguaging guide. We're in the process of publishing a translanguaging curriculum, but this is all available on the web, and it's you can print it and do with it what you wish, so you know what you're doing. But I'm going to take you through a case, because sometimes people can't imagine what this is like in a classroom. So I'm going to take you into the classroom of Camila Leyva. Camila Leyva is a high school teacher at PAIS, which is a Pan-American International High School. It's a high school for newcomers, all Spanish speakers. So all of the students are emergent bilinguals. Camila was born in the US of Chilean parents, and Camila is supposed to be the English language arts teacher, but she does something on Mondays which she calls Rap Monday, and this is what happens in Rap Monday. One of the things she does is she plays a rap, usually in Spanish, and if you know, I'm saying in Spanish, quote unquote, because if you have heard rap, you know that it's difficult to just say that it's Spanish, but anyway. In this particular Monday that I'm going to take you through, she has selected a rap from El Chivo of Quinto Sol called Si Se Puede. And what she does is she plays the video, they talk about it, they identify vocabulary, and then at some point after the long discussion, she asks them to do number two. That is, she gives them the text in Spanish, and she asks him to translate into English. This translation takes many forms. Sometimes the student can really translate into English. That is the objective of that task, so students understand that. Some of the newcomers who arrived yesterday cannot do it, but they pick up one or two words because they're always working in groups, and those groups, of course, those pairs, and those groups are, they're all, as I said before, emergent bilinguals, but at different points of the bilingual continuum. Some with very little English, some with more developed English. So they work through this, using, of course, Google Translate, using iPads, using dictionaries, using each other, the peers, and using the teacher also. After she gets finished with Si Se Puede, she does M&M, and she does Mush, of course. And at the end, and she does exactly the same thing, just as I told you, and then at the end of this, she asks him to translate it into Spanish. So notice how this English language arts class is now a bilingual class where the students are also writing in Spanish and developing their Spanish so that it doesn't fall behind. And then she asks them to compare and contrast, and that's what number 8 is about, Si Se Puede with Mosh. So that's the lesson. Some of the things that she does as far as the strategies are concerned in the process itself, notice that the reading material that is given to the kids is both in English and in Spanish. She gives a lesson in English, but she allows the students to write and research in any language. Si Se Puede, as you will see, is about immigration, and she does allow the kids to, of course, look at web pages in Spanish. She allows the discussion and the collaborative dialogue to take place with any language practice. She then makes sure that there's a product or which serves also as an assessment. So in the end, all the students make an oral multimodal presentation, supposedly in English, or write an essay in English. Again, I say as much as possible. But they're using the sources that they have read about in Spanish so that there is a lot of this going back and forth going on. And then the third step, which she always does, is this redesign or resemiologization, which is that the students then are asked to redesign their oral presentations or essay that have been done into Spanish, so that again, they are taking the English text that they have produced after much toil and then turning it into Spanish. That allows them to analyze the differences in the use of language between the English and the Spanish. And then the students are asked to design an oral presentation. She breaks up the class into three groups. One of them makes a presentation in English for a monolingual English-speaking audience. The other group makes a presentation in Spanish for a Spanish-speaking audience. And the third group makes a presentation bilingually for a bilingual audience. So the idea is to get the students to think that these bilingual practices, this translanguaging that we all have in our communities is also a valid resource within the classroom, but of course recognizing that that this has to be extended also to language used for academic purposes. I was going to take you through some of this, but I don't have that much time. But I'll just say that I just want to focus a little bit on Si Se Puede, which was the first rap. Notice that Camila always selects raps that are not only linguistically rich but also socially justice rich. So this is a rap about against the deportation of undocumented immigrants and the separation of the children. And what there is that there is a counterpoint between the English speakers who are saying that immigration is out of control and that's done in English, and then the children who are wearing t-shirts saying born in the U.S. who are making signs for a demonstration that they're planning, and these signs are in English or Spanish or whatever. I think I'm just going to read the first one in the interest of time. This is part of the dialogue that takes place after she plays the video for the first time, and I'm just going to read the first minute, no, less than a minute. So the teacher says, 4 million US citizens are being separated from their fathers and mothers because their parents are being deported. One student says, que los niños nacieron aquí, legalmente son ciudadanos, pero los padres no. Notice how, again, the students have receptive ability. They have been able to understand because there has been a lot of visual support, but they can't react in English. Another student says, entonces está la preocupación de que los separen. The teacher says, it's a very worrying situation. So because we don't have that much time, and I want to get to the M&M video, teachers are always rushed. What are 4 keywords? Las palabras importantes, palabras claves. One student says deportar, the other one says families together, the other one says protection, the other one says discrimination. The teacher says, I love how even though the song is in Spanish, we're choosing words in English. Quinto Sol grew up in the US, but they do hip hop in Spanish, and we're doing the same. I'll read one more. What problem do you see in the song, says the teacher. One student says that many white people don't like Spanish people. The other one says it's the voice of the people. The teacher says the chivo, the rapper, says that some people don't like Latinos, but one student says, no sé cómo decirlo en inglés, pero que los Latinos tenemos que pagar lo que otras personas, and then a whole bunch of people interfere, and the teacher says, don't shoot her down, we're respecting each other's opinion. What else do we see? This goes on for a while, and I'm going to skip all this, but I want to call your attention to what is happening in this supposedly English lesson through the use of translanguaging. As far as the students are concerned, the students are participating, something that they couldn't have done if the teacher had only required answers in English. They initiated participation. They elaborated ideas and found evidence. They raised questions, which otherwise they wouldn't have been able to raise. As far as the teacher is concerned, the teacher is using translanguaging to involve the students, to extend and ask questions, to clarify some of what she's teaching. But besides these discursive functions, something that she's doing with translanguaging is changing the content of the conversation and the perspective and the terms through which conversations are had. For example, she gives voice to people who haven't spoken. She problematizes, which she wouldn't have been able to do with a room full of newcomers if she had done in English only, right? A causa de que. She focuses on tensions and not just on things that are easy. This school has all Spanish speakers, which seen from the outside seem like a homogeneous group, but these students are coming from many Latin American countries, Mexico, Ecuador, Dominican Republic, Puerto Rico, etc. So one of the things that the teacher is also doing is she's really constructing this US Latino pan-ethnicity so that they can support each other. And she's also helping them construct these fluid identities. Notice that how she told them that even though the song is in Spanish, we are choosing words in English. So they're doing the same kinds of things. It's okay to be a newcomer, a Spanish speaker, and choose to speak English, right? So that she's creating these fluid identities. I want to say that translanguaging is not simply a scaffold. It's a transformative calling forth of critical and creative voices. I think there are 3 purposes that are important. One of the purposes is content, making sure that you are adapting the instruction to include everyone, building deeper background knowledge and deepening understandings. Another purpose has to do with language, because you are leveraging cross-linguistic similarities and transformations, you're raising metalinguistic awareness, you're also building some cross-linguistic flexibility, and at the same time, you are practicing in this your full repertoire to extend to the dominant school standard. I am not saying that we need to stay here. I'm saying that needs to be recognized, needs to be used, but it is also used to extend both English and Spanish used for academic purposes. And then I think very important, besides the content and language purpose, it has a social justice purpose, because after all, students then can invest in their identity, it disrupts linguistic inequality, and it really helps students develop a critical consciousness to explore this relationship between language and power. I want to say that translanguaging is not simply for transfer, but really for leveraging and transforming all the semiotic resources, that all of the resources for meaning making, for giving voice to speakers and learners, and for disrupting linguistic hierarchies of power of nation states. Notice how we are going beyond the common assumption that what we're doing is teaching for transfer. No, we are teaching for leveraging all the semiotic resources, right? So there's more going on here. One thing I think that has to be done within bilingual programs is even though there has to continue to be spaces in English and spaces in Spanish, there must be some way of also constructing a translanguaging space. That is, within the English space, you want to use some translanguaging strategies with intention, right? Not randomly. And within the Spanish space, the same. But there also has to be a space, which I don't care how you do it. I don't care if you do it once a week, while you're okay if you do it once a day. But there has to be a space where translanguaging is also valued for its own purposes. These are some examples of what some of the things that are being done. For example, a school puts aside actually a period of a week, but the class is producing a play where the characters are actually translanguage. Another one, the production of a multimedia presentation with translanguaging, a class novel or a long poem with translanguaging, a community study of translanguaging, right? Bringing in the language of the communities, the language use of the community, and reporting back to the community. So how do we build that translanguaging space that says to the children, these are practices that you have in your communities, which have some validity in here in school, rather than just say these are just not non-existent. I want to refer you back to the work of CUNY NYSIB. Sarah Hessen has put together a very nice, just a one-pager, in which she outlines what it is that we need to do when the students are reading, writing, speaking, and listening, and when the teacher is reading, writing, speaking, and listening. So, to move forward with bilingualism and the Common Core State Standards, I really think we need to build on the students' flexible languaging, their translanguaging, and what we need to do to really reconstruct and move forward is try to adopt more flexible language use strategically within the English and the load spaces, and then think of how we might have a translanguaging space. Y muchas gracias. I think I went a little bit over, but I think you're okay. Oh, sure. If I can. There it goes. Okay. Thank you for coming. What?
I wonder if you could briefly explain or describe how translanguaging is different from code switching.
Okay, but you're on right now, right?
No.
Oh. No, not in Chicago. Simply, Luis, it's epistemologically different. Code switching is done from the language perspective, right? And it's looking at language as a system, as two systems, where you're shifting from one code to the other, all right? Translanguaging is different because what we're talking about is from the perspective of the speaker. From the perspective of the speaker, when I text my children, I am not going between English and Spanish. I am using my linguistic repertoire, my full linguistic repertoire. And as a matter of fact, I think the best example I can always give, and then when I give this example, everybody understands. You know the iPhone, how you have to change languages? That is code switching. That is expecting me to change a language every time I text and I put a Spanish word in. Translanguaging is about turning off the iPhone function, the language function in the iPhone. Right? So it accepts all our repertoire rather than just some. Okay? I think there's someone else. I mean, I would take questions, but nobody's in charge here. So I'm happy to, it's lunchtime? All right, I'm happy to stay. I just don't want to take someone else's time. Yeah.
Hi,
Yeah, I could. It's heavy on pictures, as you see. But if you write to me, I can put it in a Dropbox for you. Yeah, all right. There are no naive questions. No, I don't think it's a scaffold, and I think I said that clearly. I think if what you see with Camila's classroom, and that's why I brought you Camila's classroom, is that these students are really getting practice, developing, of course, their English, which is the objective of that lesson that she's teaching, but also developing and maintaining literacy in Spanish, right? Especially in Wales, I mean, they always say this, translanguaging is not to scaffold, it's not to make it simpler or easier. On the contrary, is to make sure that everybody gets to the very difficult concepts using whatever resources they have and extending them in ways that are going to let them then, of course, develop in academic English, if one want to call it that, and then Spanish for academic purposes, or the other language for academic purposes. Yes. Well, this school is all the. How does it look like at the end? This is like a slice of a classroom. This school is for newcomers, and it's a high school. And I can tell you that in the 11th and the 12th grade, the students are still engaged in this because 4 years is just not enough, especially with having raised the standards as we have. So that what I would say in this particular school is that they have the 9th and 10th grades together and the 11th and 12th grade together. As I observed the 11th and the 12th grade, the English language arts teacher maybe has a little bit more emphasis on getting to their English, but there is a lot of support also for Spanish language development. So I would think that you know, they do less of it, but it doesn't disappear in any kind of way. No. Yes. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely, all the time. Yeah, there are two things I want to say. You don't need a bilingual teacher to do this, right? You can do this with a teacher who understands the students, the students' language resources, and you can do it in a heterogeneous class. We work with one school where there are a lot of Polish kids, Spanish-speaking kids, and Uzbeki also, Tajikan also. So, and this particular teacher does it beautifully. And the way that you do it is you do it because now you depend a lot more on the students. It takes a different kind of teacher. It takes, you know, I always say this takes an epistemological change not only on language but also on teaching because it takes grouping effectively so that the kids, the peers, can really help each other. But yeah, what he does is he groups the children according to home language, and he lets them use their own language resources to come up with whatever it is that they're learning. So, Say it again. Community engagement, absolutely. Right, absolutely, and that is that's very important because a lot of the teachers that we work with are also working with the parents who come in and translate stuff, who come in and you know, read to the kids in different languages so that they can be acknowledged. So yes, that has the community language use is at the center of what's being done. Yeah, I'm sorry, back there.
Ah.
Is Alexis here? Alexis is here. You have to talk to Alexis, who works at ETS and is developing a translanguage assessment to make sure that we understand how much children know about math. So I think that is coming. Alexis, raise your hand. They want to see who you are. They want to hold you accountable. It's going to be a few years, but it's coming. It's coming. That is an issue, you know, right? That the assessment is usually done in one language or the other. And even in New York City, where we translate tests and we give the tests in the two languages, we tell the kids it can only be in one language, either in English or Russian. It can't be in both. Alexis is taking care of that. Yes. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Are you concerned at all about that turning into some sort of Spanglish?
No. No. Remember I said this is not about hybridity. I told you that this is not about mixture. This is about fluidity. It's different. What we would consider Spanglish, quote unquote, whether that is exists or not is contested, but anyway, what people consider Spanglish is usually a corrupted, stigmatized concept. I think what we're talking about is a concept of potentiality, of growth, of development. It's taking the language practices, but making sure that we don't see them as stigmatized, but that the children see it as valid, and therefore that can be extended. I think that anybody that has language practices that they feel are stigmatized and corrupted in any way cannot possibly develop, let's say, Spanish, right? They can't. I mean, if you think you speak Spanglish, you will never develop Spanish. But if you think that what you do is normal among bilingual populations, then I think you have more of a comfort level when you are in that situation to be able to extend the practices to encompass more academic ones. There was a question back there. You have another question, but I'll come back to you. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, for dual language. Right. 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 And I think we've gone overboard with the protection, right? I think we've gone overboard with a space so rigid that it doesn't allow the children to use language creatively and critically. And I think translanguaging is all about creativity and criticality. So what I would recommend is what I said at the end, that there has to be, not to eliminate those spaces, right? Because I think they serve a purpose. But within those spaces, to have a little bit of flexibility, which is, after all, what teachers have, right? We have described it, you know, language policy is funny. We describe it like, this is what should be happening in classrooms. When you walk in and you sit day after day, that's not what's happening. It's a lot more fluid because the teachers are intelligent and they want to make sure that the kids get what it is that they're teaching. So there's a lot more of that, those fluid language practices that already exist in those classrooms. Besides that, we have lost a lot in bilingual education. We are a profession that has wounds. And I understand that people are threatened by anything that is going to destabilize certain types of programs, et cetera. So, you know, it doesn't have to be done every day, but I think once a week, a creative lesson that actually gets the kids thinking about how to translanguage, how to write a novel in which there's a family like mine where people are coming in with their wives and husbands or whatever, and there's always someone that does not have the language in which you're working, so you have to go back and forth. Those are situations that the children never see in books. So I think that there is a real advantage of, at creating that. And I think if it's performance oriented, so it's a it's project oriented, I think it works beautifully. Yeah, yeah. Okay, thank you. Right. 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 Right.
Then I'm allowing them that it's okay to be using all this English.
Right. Right. So two things. Look at our website and download the Translanguaging Guide. It was done by former students of mine, colleagues, and I think you'll find a lot of examples there. But secondly, I think that we have to get away from the concept of language maintenance as we have used it in the U.S. You know, I speak of language sustainability. And sustainability has to do with the interaction of language with the political and social context, not just language by itself. And I think if you think of bilingualism in a place like Europe where that are really pushing the mother tongue plus two additional languages, the idea is to sustain their language practices, not to maintain them rigidly. And I think that's a concept that we need to work with. We, you know, as I said before, I understand the threat, right? But I think we would do well in relaxing a little bit. That's what I'm saying. Don't do away with the spaces, but create some activities in which there is some of this going on. Right. Everybody feels guilty. Right. 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 Everybody feels guilty. And that, I think that's part of taking away the guilt of bilingualism in the U.S. to say, okay, it's all right. You know, teachers can do it, students can do it. And this not going to mean that we corrupt either English or Spanish. It's actually going to be a way of developing it, because children will then feel more secure in their language use. They don't feel insecure. Linguistic insecurity is what kills a language, right? Yes.
So to use what you express, how do you write into languages, for instance? It's been done throughout ages. If you believe war and peace,
right. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
So,
right.
In English, I use only, but it's a fact of life. I am of Russian descent. You go to a Russian store, you hear a salesperson using some English, some Russian words, and that's not so terrible. But when they merge those and Russify English words or anglicize Russian words, it sounds really.
Yeah, so, you know, when I was very young, I was taught by a sociolinguist who was the first person, the first scholar who studied bilingualism in the U.S., Norwegian bilingualism, Einar Haugen. And Einar, you always used to tell me, it is better to bend than to break in situations of bilingualism. I think that is such an important lesson that we have not learned. If we keep insisting, this is the only way to use English, this is the only way to use Russian, in a globalized world where these languages are always in contact, there is no way that it will break. The only way to make it go forward is indeed to bend a little bit, to be a little bit more flexible. Yes. Yeah.
I like your approach. I knew it very Right.
Random. I think if you again look at our website, you will find some principles there that we have developed. It's a very difficult thing to answer with one thing, because I think one of the uses of translanguaging is to adapt instruction. You know, we set up rooms as if those kids started in kindergarten and fourth grade, they're still there. That doesn't happen. I mean, I was in a school on Monday where there were 11 newcomers since January. 11 newcomers. So it's for those students, you have to adapt your language use, because otherwise they're lost completely. So it's hard to give a black and white answer. It's complicated. But I think as long as teachers are taught to use it strategically and not to feel guilty about using it, and the kids to know that this is actually a good language practice, that it can get them knowing about things that they don't know, that when you do a research project, you don't only have to look at the websites in English, you can also look at the websites in Russian. I think that builds a certain comfort level with being bilingual. That is what we don't have. What we have lost is the sense that bilingualism is really more dynamic. And I think now I'm happy to talk to you, but I think in the interest of everybody, I think I'll let you all go to lunch, right? Okay, gracias.